Next up, I'm going to give Saul Griffith exactly the introduction he asked for, and the introduction is, this is Saul.
This wasn't why I asked for that introduction, but as just an engineer, I find it fairly challenging to follow a producer with Sandra Bullock and an architect with Dita Von Teese. But we'll see how we do. So I'm Saul Griffith from Otherlab. We are a R&D and engineering company locally. We are on the capture, compute, create spectrum. We do all of these things, but we're really very heavy on the compute and on the create. One of the products is actually a spin-out company of ours. This is Other Machine Company, Danielle Applestone. You'll be able to find her out here later today showing this. This is an extremely high precision desktop CNC machine that can do everything from circuit boards to metals. And you can see here, you know, these machines are precise enough to do very tight control for circuit boards. We are actually writing our own software. You know, in the 90s, WYSIWYG was everything. What you see is what you get in printing. I think in terms of CAM, we need WYSIWYM, which is what you see is what you make. So we're pushing towards that. So the CAM program actually renders what you're going to make. So this thing can make products like this. We have a lot of customers that are actually using this desktop CNC for actual manufacture of real products that meet local demands. This sort of speaks to the precision of it. This is a captured coffee mug. It's actually rendered in hardwood out of that little desktop mill. So the real theme of what I was going to talk about is precision is cheap and getting cheaper. Control is cheap and getting cheaper. Geometry is very cheap to compute now and getting cheaper to compute. Geometry is cheap to measure, which plays in heavily into a lot of things we do. And I think the really important thing in software is we want more and more to do this. What you see is what you make. So from there, I'm actually going to detour a little bit. And forgive me if this presentation seems new. I thought I would do this at about 11 o'clock last night. So the story behind what I'm going to talk about is I was in Washington, D.C. for another meeting in late October. And everyone might remember this was peak Ebola in the news time. And I was invited to a very small meeting at the Department of Defense where a lot of extremely smart people worry about infectious diseases and their transmission. And they were very worried about this. So you might recognize this. This is a PPE, or a personal protective equipment. One of the major tragedies of the Ebola outbreak this time around is about 1 in 4 of the victims are the caregivers, the doctors and the nurses and the caregivers who do the treatment. And most of the infections of those doctors are because they break the protocol when they're taking these things on and off and trying to remove all of the pieces. So not only concerned about this particular Ebola outbreak, which, you know, the game isn't over yet and it is becoming an endemic, which changes the strategies that I'll talk about a little bit. But you know, we need to solve this problem generically because we will have these types of problems again. So literally, this was a drawing we drew. Excuse the language if you read it carefully. Luckily, my handwriting is bad. But how do you, rather than, you know, try and cover the doctor and send them into this highly infectious environment and prevent them from being infected, why don't we instead invert the procedure and isolate the patients and then allow the doctor to interact with the patients through a device. And you know, for the late stages of the disease, that's very important, but for the early stages, when you're still in sort of the purgatory or you've presented with fever, is it malaria or is it Ebola, in the initial response, all of these people were put into the same containment areas where there was a very high likelihood of cross-infection. So even in those very early stages, can you do this type of things? And because it's a developing world application, you have to be hugely cost sensitive. So we propose to build extremely low cost, inflatable structure, plastic containment units. Now, one of the most important things is to interact with the patient, not only for the doctor, but these patients, you know, often need to be isolated for up to 20 days, they would like to also interact with their their family and members of the community. So we actually kind of conceived of this notion called the hug wall. So this is the inversion of the PPE. So this is the very early prototype with Leanne, who was critical to the project. And this gets welded into the side of our thing. So how does all this relate to capture, compute, and create? Well, really, the capture side of this is these diseases evolve very quickly. In fact, they saw evolution of the virus during this outbreak and continue to see it. But not only just does disease evolve, but what we know about how to treat it and react to it evolves. During this particular Ebola outbreak, we went from thinking it was a hemorrhagic fever to understanding that most of the deaths were caused by dehydration. So quickly rehydrating the patients takes them from 20% survivability to 80 or 90% survivability. This is why most of the Western doctors who come back to be treated in their home countries survive. So what we really proposed was not to design, because it's very unclear that anyone is expert enough of these diseases to get exactly the right isolation unit. We wanted to design essentially the 3D printer of all possible solutions to this problem, so that in the field you could design and rebuild the containment units as necessary for the evolving natures of the disease, and even whether you're doing the initial outbreaks were in cities where you wanted 120 bed solutions. Now, as the disease has evolved and it's becoming endemic rather than pandemic, it's much smaller outbreaks in rural villages where you want 6 to 8 bed emergency treatment units. And so you have to, in some respects, we were trying to design a generic solution. So this is where we come in with our expertise in computational geometry and in CNC machine design. Let's design a generic CNC machine that you can feed 8-foot rolls of plastic and produce any large number of these devices in real time. So we actually buy now 2,000-pound rolls of industrial polyethylene plastic, feed it into a machine, and laser weld it, and depending upon what features you want. So this is actually the very first. We voided the warranty on our $250,000 laser made by Metabeam, and we put a roll feed in there. This was how we made the very first prototypes. And then we did a whole lot of design work on, in the top left-hand corner, it turns out there's a huge demand from the patients to have showers. So, what we learned from the nurses who do a spectacular, and the caregivers on the ground, is they looked at our designs and they said, this is cool, what we really need is a shower. 2 days later, we actually can prototype showers. Below that, in B, if the virus becomes an airborne virus or we want to treat a different infectious disease where you need to filter the air, HEPA filters require a huge amount of power. We actually had to conceive of and manufacture a serpentine gravity separating filter that rather than run at 1,000 watts, what runs about 15 watts, so that you can run this for days and days and days off a car battery. Anyway, all of these features become essentially parameterized components. You'll see in D, that's one of the hug walls in prototype. We work on all the technical features of these things, and then we set about building a machine to build it. So I think what is spectacular about this is the timeline on which these things can play out. So now we're basically at the end of December, having started this work in mid-November. So we've already produced prototypes on a rough machine. In order to be able to respond appropriately to this outbreak, you would actually like to put a machine in country to produce the devices for sociological and political reasons, as well as technical reasons. So we set about complete design and build of a completely novel laser welding, laser cutting CNC machine. You can see we went through all the calculations of how you need to build this, right down to the control. What's spectacular now is that you can conceive of and execute on building, in this case, it's really a four-axis CNC machine in a matter of weeks. Here's the laser. It's, sort of plug and play. We had to build a very custom feed and material handling solution for this. The actual manufacturing cell looks like this. We're about to, probably next week, we will bring this online. On the left, that's the laser cutting and welding. Then we have one assembly table that sort of folds the last seams of this thing. We actually had to write our own simulators to do the compensation for the deformations that would happen when you inflate these things. That's so that we could appropriately compensate. You know, I think this is a very interesting trend in manufacturing. Traditional manufacturing, you make everything out of rigid pieces, and the what you have in CAD is what a big rigid machine builds you in rigid materials. I think a hugely interesting future is you're going to use soft or compliant materials. The machine under load, so in this case, under the load of having air passing through the filter or air beams built in, you have to compute that geometry, reverse it out, and sort of compensate for that in the manufacturing. And that's where computers coming in very heavily. So our goals, we're actually in discussions now to deploy exactly this. So as Ebola has become an endemic, it's going into villages, you would like very lightweight solutions that can be deployed in a matter of days. As you've probably learned, if you have followed this disease, the sooner you can get in there and isolate the patients, the better chance you have of preventing the disease spreading. So you would like to be able to sort of drop ship these things. We can now manufacture an individual one of these care cubes. It takes us about 28 minutes on our custom machine. That's about $120 worth of materials as the input, a few hours of labor to assemble it. And the whole thing weighs about 40 pounds. In fact, we might, well, this is the machine. It's as photographed yesterday. It'll be online next week. This is the lighthearted photograph to say, while you're working on a disease like this and you learn more depressing things than you want to know, and it's Halloween and your son says, bring something cool home, you're like, oh, we could use that to make inflatable dinosaurs. That's the lighthearted. I had to keep it real, keep it lighthearted. Anyway, so we'll actually bring one of these tents out right now and you can have a look at this. But I think really, I have been known to say, just for shits and giggles really, that if you want to create expensive landfills slowly, you choose a 3D printer. But that's a little too critical of 3D printing. I think 3D printing is extremely cool. But the real revolution... Try to bring any other house into a theater in real time. So there we go, we can just sit that there. You can see all of the structure here is an air beam structure. This is actually the hug wall. I pre-inflated this, and that was the horrible noise you heard before we started the show. I will show you the video of this inflating. So this is really 3 minutes to go to fully inflate this device. This is Charlie Avis, an architect who helped put us all together. There was a wonderful young man called Sam Sarsia who did all the engineering on our CNC. But I think, you know, what's incredible to me is in little under 12 weeks, you can now produce a completely new CNC machine, multiple axes. We actually are doing capacitive following, so we're actually computing the differences in the where we believe when you're building such a big machine, it's very hard to make it accurate over such a large area. So we actually have the laser head follow the deformations in the very large bed. And you can produce, you know, such a novel machine that can make a very large array of devices. This will not only be used to make isolation units, but pieces of PPEs. It will be used to make the chambers in which you test to do the diagnostics on blood samples. And I think to me, what's really exciting about where we are with capture, compute, and create is that you can conceive of, you know, essentially a 3D printing machine for almost any material set, just by building multiple axis CNC. So here it is, you know, a couple of minutes and it's up. We're actually using a fish tank pump, dribbles air in there to keep it inflated over a period of a month. So it's even robust to pinholes and leaks. And you can see these are actually pass-throughs for food and pass-outs for infected matter. This is the hug wall. There's a window, so you can interact from both sides with the patient. You can see here that you have enough room to actually touch all corners of the isolation unit. There you go. So I'll leave it there. Thanks very much. Come and see me later. And let's create a really great future together. Thanks.